Let's talk about the estimation of fracture toughness. Not all cases are covered in available material data, like, for example, Ifunda or many other sources and textbooks. There are situations for where you can't find the plain strain fracture toughness of many materials. So we need to have methods to estimate that value if we can't find it, or at least a method to confirm a specific value that we calculate from our test results. Now, a test that's very often done is the Sharpie impact, or the impact tests on specimens. Now, that Sharpie test that they do is essentially a fracture energy. And there are equations that correlate that energy value to the plain strain fracture toughness. Because in a Sharpie test, you measure the total fracture energy of the specimen, that specimen that you've tested. And that's basically the integral of energy as a function of, which is a function of crack size over that ligament. If the R curve would be horizontal, the value of the integral divide by ligament would be R. So that comes from other theories. So your stress intensity, your plain strain, your fracture toughness K becomes equal to the square root of the energy and the integral R. For the low toughness at the lower shelf, the R curve will be nearly horizontal. You don't know what it is yet. And there is correlation between K1C and Sharpie energy. And we're going to look at that in a while. There are the empirical equations that you can use. The equation there at the top is in joules and MPa square root meter, which is what I prefer to use. An empirical correlation for plain strain fracture toughness, according to Brook, is this one. And the conservative lower bound was found to be this one. So what we at Investmech do is we normally calculate, if we have that impact energy, we take that impact energy, this Sharpie value, and we put it into these equations, and we calculate the K1C values, and we use the lowest value that we calculate. That is if we have no other information. When we want to test a potential upper bound, we will use this one. A lower bound is normally given by this one. Now, you know, typical steel, let me put my math up in there. The energy value of a typical steel is, say, let's say 30 joule. So let's say energy is equal to 30 joule. Then you can see the K1C value can be either equal to 11.4, that's the upper value there, multiplied by by energy, divided by 0.5, but it could also be, and I could put this in a, it could also be equal to 21.6 times the energy to the power 0.17. And those are the two values that we will get, 62 and 38 MPa square root meter. And you will realize that many steels are in that typical range. If you have a large energy value, let's say you measured something like 50 joule, then of course we end up with 80 and 42. 42 our lower bound, very conservative lower bound, but we do use that in design. We like that conservatism when we do design in estimating the maximum allowable or the critical crack size on a cross section. Now, what about loading rates and temperature shifts? Because people ask us those questions a lot. Toughness values on the previous slide would be the same, would be for the same high loading rates impact as prevalent in the Sharpie test, because that's where they come from. So the toughness for slower loading rates may be obtained from some equations because that happens at slower. Now, I don't give you all those equations. You can find them in research that's published in papers. So what I'm just mentioning is there are values available for slower loading rates. Temperature shifts. To account for temperature, materials between 250 MPa and 965 MPa yield strength, we take into account with that equation. Delta T, right, that's taken into account in the calculation is 119 minus that factor, and otherwise it's equal to 0 degrees Celsius. As shown, materials with a low yield strength can tolerate a large temperature shift than one with high yield strength, as is expected because of its brittleness. Slower loading will cause transition temperature to be lower, and the estimate of toughness will be useful if the loading rate is low, even at low temperatures. There are several other empirical equations in literal to model temperature, and yeah, I don't know, I included it here. What you can use as a comparison of this, a fissure suite will fail brittle at low temperature and ductile at high temperature. That shows you behavior there. A material is available with a Sharpie value of 20 foot pounds. The yield strength is 60 KSI, temperature 65 degrees Fahrenheit. Estimate the toughness for high loading rates and comment. Firstly, I like to convert, but you can use the equations for those units as well. 1 PSI is 6.89 kilopascal, 1 PSI. So 1 KSI is 6.895 megapascal. 1 foot pound is 1.35582 joule. 65 degrees Fahrenheit is 18.3 degrees Celsius. We calculate the plane strain fracture toughness and we get it 59.4 MPa. We calculate the conservative lower bound and that's 38 MPa. Now comments. The plane strain fracture toughness estimated here of 59.4 would be safe value to use because toughness would be higher for slow loading, applicable even at a low temperature of minus 47.2 degrees Celsius for this material. Now, how does the fracture mechanisms look like? The Sharpie impact energy is affected by changes in the fracture mechanism. Metals usually fracture by microvoid coalescence, in which the plastic strain causes void nucleation around inclusions. These grow and leak up until fracture occurs. In body-centered cubical metals, failure can also occur by cleavage. The one that you see there below, that's how it looks like. As the yield strength of the metal is increased, the tensile stress in the plastic zone can become sufficiently high for cleavage to occur. The fracture mechanism in a ferritic carbon steel therefore changes from microwave coalescence to cleavage as the yield strength increases, which is caused by an increase in strain rate or a decrease in temperature. The work of fracture of cleavage is much less than the work of fracture of microvoid coalescence, since it involves much less plastic deformation. The change in fracture mechanism, therefore, causes a sharp ductile to brittle transition in the Sharpie impact energy test. Now, what is the relationship for EN25? I only have this one. There are many others. For 0.976 correlation coefficient, we can see K1C is equal to minus 0.53 SUT plus 188.12. So it's 188.12 minus 0.53 SUT. K1C is the plane strain fracture toughness in KSI inch in this case. SUT is the ultimate tensile strength in KSI. Oh, you can convert this to MPa if you wish. But that's one equation to relate that. We have other equations as well. Here we have one in terms of yield strength and the strain at fracture. And then we have another one as a function of Sharpie impact. Here they square root 2 the whole function times E, where E is the modulus of elasticity. So you can also use modulus of elasticity with Sharpie V to calculate K1C. What is the toughness at upper shelf? Upper shelf Sharpe energy is not directly related to toughness. If the R curve, that's your strain release rate, energy release rate, curve rises steeply, which it does at the upper shelf integral of RA over ligament, is not universally relatable to R. Much of Sharpe energy on upper shelf is used for general specimen deformation rather than fracture. Nevertheless, empirical correlations are available. And here you can read again to get very valuable other information on fracture toughness of materials. If you have time, go and download that document from NASA. It gives you, there's a lot of valuable information in that document as well. Right, let's...